Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Beyond the Saga. Dave Cottingham here with Hannah Burr. Good evening, Hannah.
Good evening. How are you?
Doing great. We are trying to wrap up this Star Wars series. We've got the next two volumes here. We're going to do volume 12. And then be on the lookout for volume 13 shortly after so we can wrap this up and get on to the next Star Wars series or something else, whatever. But this is a long, these have been a long one, 75 issues. We are talking about volume 12, which is called Rebels and Rogues. And it was written by Greg Pak, who has not written anything before this as far as this series go. Greg Pak obviously has been writing a ton of comic books before. I'm very well familiar with him on the DC line. But this was issue 68 to 72. This volume came out November of 2019. This follows volume 11, where we saw the scorching of Shoe Torn, if you remember that, Hannah. So this kind of sets up our rebels where they've escaped, you know, and kind of gotten their revenge on Queen Trios, right? Is that her name? Trios. And now they're getting close. I mean, we're getting really close, obviously, to Hoth and to the Empire Strikes Back. So now there's this mission where our heroes have got to be split up in order to deviate the probes that are going out there to find our rebels so that they can safely establish on Hoth. So, Hannah, as always, what were your overall thoughts on this volume? And here it is, by the way, this volume here. Yeah. Chewbacca and 3PO.
To be completely honest, my entire thought was, huh? I'm sure you agree that kind of just sums it up. I mean, obviously Luke still has that, for lack of a better term, a plot B where he's still trying to learn the Force. He's still trying to find people who are Force sensitive to help give him some guidance of some kind. But yes, they're splitting up to kind of distract the fact that they're building a base on Hoth. And, trying to find an established location. But in the process, Luke runs into someone who claims to be Force sensitive. And so he's like, oh, maybe she can help me. And then Han and Leia run into Leia's ex-boyfriend. So, you know, hijinks ensues. Han gets very jealous. And then you have Chewbacca and C-3PO doing something with sentient rock people.
Yeah.
So it's a ride.
Yes, it's a ride.
It's a ride. I appreciate the creative liberty, but I feel like there's a line, and I feel like someone was dancing across the line to and fro. So, but overall, it's definitely still us reaching to the point where we can start episode 5, Empire Strikes Back. We're still getting to that point. I still think it's important that we get to that point, especially because that's the purpose of this whole series. But it's interesting is my takeaway. What about you?
I share the same thoughts. I feel like because looking back, and I know this is not the last volume. I'll probably talk more about it on the last one. But leading up to this is a writer change, right? Most of these books have been written by Karen Gillan and Jason Aaron before that. So it's like I feel like the momentum that they've built and to me I feel like there wasn't that much of a change into the creative when the writers changed. Then I feel like it was a little different this time around. Personally, I haven't been a huge fan of Greg Pak's work. I'll just go ahead and say it. There was a couple of, like I said, DC comics that he wrote that I didn't really get into as much as I did some other ones. You know, this one, I will say that this one started well. I feel like
yes,
in the beginning when you had General Ryken and he's talking to, and Ryken's the one that kind of lays this whole plan out and separates the team. And I thought, okay, well, this is going to be cool. They're, you know, stakes are high. We got to get the teams out there to make sure that the rest of the rebels are safe. But like you said, once it got into it, it was like it didn't feel as dangerous as
yes,
as it made it lead out to be, you know. So, you know, I mean, we got a little bit more. We got some dynamic between Han and Leia, of course. Luke still kind of searching for what to do with a lightsaber and, you know, his Jedi skills. And then Chewbacca and 3PO, which is kind of an odd pairing going out on their own. So, I mean, I found myself wanting to get to the end just because I want to get to the end.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, that was I was like, can I just skim through this? Like, I hate to say that.
Yeah.
But it just, and maybe it's the same as my reaction to The Last Jedi, if it was outside the context of where it was put or where it was placed and set, I might have liked it more.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's just, I don't know. If for trying to wrap up a bunch of loose ends before we enter The Empire Strikes Back, it felt too much. And it felt like all of a sudden all these other open-ended questions were asked and mm-hmm. we don't get closure on them. So I completely yeah. agree with you.
Yeah.
It's just weird.
Yeah. And of course, you know, with the struggle thing, the thing I struggle with too a little bit too is with each one of these volumes that we've done on the show here, they have a conclusion. You know, this one is left open because it pretty much leads into right into the last, like, I think two or three issues of the series in the next volume. So it really is, even though we're going to do these separately, it's almost one big story with all these issues. So, you know, when we talk about kind of how this one goes, you know, plays out in these six issues, was it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 issues? It ends open ended, right? So, in that sense kind of felt like it just dragged a little bit. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, I know we're bouncing around, but it just felt like it just kind of was filling in almost, you know. I don't want to call it a filler issue, but it was kind of getting us to a point, but it didn't really get us, I don't think, in a relevant way to how dire everything kind of sounded.
But if you were to pick though one of the three stories to follow mm-hmm. of your, which one's your favorite?
I think it would have to be the Han and Leia one, to be honest, just because really? Yeah, because I think Luke kind of on his own and, you know, running into this person that ultimately ended up just kind of, I don't know if it's spoiling anything, giving too much away, but it's like, it's kind of turning on him a little bit, you know? But he's not, I don't feel like he was doing much. The Chewbacca, you know, the rock people, like you said, that was just kind of strange. The Han and Leia one, at least I liked seeing them interacting and, you know, kind of his jealousy kind of set in a little bit, because we are getting to Empire, and when we get to Empire, there is that tension, that emotional tension between the two. And this kind of has a hint of that in there. So I liked that a little bit, and I liked kind of that storyline a little bit better about them trying to frame this guy to make it seem like he's a rebel sympathizer, and you know that the Empire would turn on, you know, kind of. Anyway, that's kind of their mission in a sense, right? So that was kind of the only one I kind of liked following, because them two were involved with it more so. You?
I mean, I totally agree with you, but I also liked the Luke one in the sense of, the thing is, yes, I agree with you, where he's kind of on its own. It's kind of a, oh, look, someone betrayed me, type of dealio. But I will say this. I think the benefit of that, though, is that Luke saw someone who was a force wielder who wasn't trained as a Jedi, but they trained themselves on how to use the force. And while it was limited what they could do, to me, that sort of gave Luke a bit of hope that, like, okay, if I can't find someone, maybe I can do some of this on my own. But I agree with you. The Leia Han story was definitely more interesting. I mean, who doesn't like to see Han a little jealous?
I know, right? Yeah.
Is that perfectly?
And I will say the artwork was really good, because, I mean, it was, I mean, if you look at their faces, I mean, it's Harrison Ford and Carrie Fisher. I mean, it's
totally exact. Is.
Where sometimes, you know, it's just a little different, a little off. But this clearly is them. And her hairstyle is very similar to what she is in Empire Strikes Back. And, you know, even Luke looks like, I mean, dead on what Mark Hamill looked like then, you know. So it was, I got into the artwork really easily. I mean,
yes,
it did draw you in. Looks like he's on Tatooine, but he's actually on a planet called Sergia, I think.
There are too many similar planets to Tatooine in this freaking galaxy. That's all I gotta say. Too many.
They end up going too to a desert planet almost every time, right?
Yeah. I know. It's like, how many desert planets are out there?
Yeah, yeah.
Give me a, I don't know, and something different. I can't think of anything that would be different, but just give me something different. Let's not start off.
Well, we've seen sand, we've seen forest, we've seen water. I mean, but you know, but we don't really see, I feel like we don't see that many exotic ones like Felucia, where there's a big plant and stuff, or what?
Kashyyyk,
yes. You know, Kijimi, which was in Rise of Skywalker, is like a snow planet.
What about a savanna?
A savanna? Like
the African savanna?
Oh, yeah. I don't know if we've ever seen that.
Let's see that.
Huh, yeah. You mean basically like a desert with plant life?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, interesting.
With a few trees every now and again. Or let's have a planet completely surrounded with ocean.
That's Kamino.
Oh, yeah, Kamino. Never mind. But we need more. But do you see my point?
We need more Kaminos, right? Yeah.
Exactly. It's like,
I feel like we need more Coruscants, actually.
I would love more Coruscants.
I don't feel like we see too many just massive cities. Like, we see cities.
We need more of that. Like, I find it very, very hard to believe that all these solar systems seemingly have at least 3 desert planets per solar system.
Yeah. Yes.
And no city planet, no water planet, except for, that one and that one.
Yes.
Like, I find that very hard to believe.
I do too. Yeah, I do too. Okay, so like we said, this is leading into the final volume, which you can check out this, you know, shortly if it's not out already. But overall, let's talk about. I think we can save. To be honest, I think we can save the impact of this story because it kind of continues in the next one.
I would agree.
But what's your rating of this volume itself?
I'm sorry. It's not one of my favorites. I'm going to give it a 2.
Two. Oh, okay.
It just, yeah.
I won't go that. I'll say 2.5.
You're a little more gracious than me.
A little more gracious. A little more. But, you know, it reminded me because I did remember that because we were going to maybe record this a week or two ago, and I read it, and then we're like, okay, well, let's do it this week. I actually, I kind of forgot what I read, so I had to go back and kind of skim through it, and I was like...
That was me. Right before this, I was like, wait, what was that about?
Yeah. So that's where the impact of it wasn't that high, and... you know, it's there to continue the story and get you to Hoth. So
it feels like a filler. It really does. I'm sorry.
Yeah. I'm not sure, which we can get into in the next one because there's a book called Empire Ascendant right after the series that kind of leads into Hoth. And yeah, you can make the argument that you can just go right into that one, but you know, we'll see. We'll talk about that in the next one, volume 13. Saga. Yes. Anything else on this one, Hannah?
I really don't think there is.
I really don't think so either. Yeah. Thanks everybody for watching and listening. Go check out Beyond the Sagas on youtube.com/InsideTheForce or on any podcast feed. We will be back next with volume 13 to finish up this comic series, Star Wars comic series. And then of course, you know, a lot more Beyond the Sagas coming your way. For Hannah Burr, thank you, Hannah.
Thank you.
As always, take care, everybody. See you next time. May the Force be with you.